someone's been talking, which is a good thing, because this week I got accosted by someone that is not a church member, and she came up to me and she was telling me all about our Easter service, and so I'm glad that some of you were telling about Easter and about other things going on in this church to other people. That's a wonderful thing. Also, on that same regard, I want to share with you a letter we received this week. This letter came, and I'm just going to summarize some of the highlights here. But it starts with, my mother passed away at UPMC in her hospital in the early morning of Sunday, March 21st, 2021, at the age of 91. She goes on to talk about the medical conditions and such. But she says when they went to the elevator, the doctors had said it was grim. It didn't look good. I walked along with my mother and her nurses as we rode the elevators and went down the halls to the room for the night. They opened the door to her room, and it was absolutely perfect. It had a huge window. The sun was shining, and a panoramic view of St. Mark's church bell and the cross. I knew right then that from this point on, she was in God's hands. I stayed with her until 8 p.m., kissed her and told her I loved her, and shortly after she had cardiac arrest and died. After the funeral, the director handed me her belongings in a bag, which I knew were her pajamas and her necklace. Upon opening the bag, I saw this blanket and immediately thought, oh no, I have someone else's stuff. After being transferred and calling the hospital to the appropriate department, this kind gentleman explained the meaning and significance behind the quilted comforter that was given to my mom. So I just wanted to thank you personally for your love, your prayers, and such a kind and thoughtful gesture for all loved ones. So I wanted to share that with you. I think it's a wonderful example of the ministry that we do. The sewing ladies put these quilts together. They're given to the hospital for this type of situation. And so we give thanks for everybody who shares the message out in the world and the people that do it by sewing or many other means, sharing that love of Christ. Thank you very much. Are there any other announcements anybody would like to share? If not, let us now open our hearts and open our minds as we prepare to worship our Lord this day with our prayer. Thank you. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your Spirit moved over the waters, and by your word you created the world, calling forth life in which you took delight. Through the waters of the flood you delivered Noah and his family. Through the sea you led your people Israel from slavery into freedom. At the river your son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By water and your word, you claim us as daughters and sons, making us heirs of your promise and servants of all. We praise you for the gift of water that sustains life, and above all, we praise you for the gift of new life in Jesus Christ. Shower us with your Spirit and renew our lives with your forgiveness, your grace, and your love. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated. enable us to show the power of the resurrection in all that we say and do, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And at this point, I invite the children to come down to share their music abilities in this time of COVID as much as they can. Pre-recorded voices and our playing instruments too.
They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each the reality of God is light, but our confessed reality has been sin. God cleanses us from all, from our sinful reality through Christ's death, so that we may live in fellowship with Christ and walk in God's light. St. John wrote, "We declare to you what was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands, concerning the word of life. This life was revealed, and we have seen it and testified to it, and declare to you the eternal life that was with the Father and was revealed to us. We declare to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus' Son cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate for the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let's please rise. Lord, to whom shall we go?
You have the words of eternal life. Alleluia.
The Holy Gospel for this Sunday, the second Sunday of Easter, is taken from the Gospel of John, the 20th chapter. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my fingers in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? yet have come to believe. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing, you may have life in his name. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Grace and peace to you from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. In the words of my mouth and the ears of our hearts, be open to the word of God this day. Amen. This week I heard a sermon from a mega pastor. Now, a mega church is classified by all church experts as a church that meets with over 2,000 people or more. Now, there's many churches in Hanover, but none of them are classified as mega churches. We have many churches of all different sizes, but none that are over 2,000 of them. A mega church. And this mega church pastor was talking about being church in the time of COVID and what it means. He was saying it doesn't matter what size we were. If we were a mega church, a 100-member church, a 500-member church, a 20-member church, or just two people, it wouldn't matter. Because when COVID came, all churches were stuck in the same boat. All churches found themselves instantly not being able to meet in person. We couldn't meet because we had fear and worry about spreading the disease, this pandemic. We couldn't have fellowship because any fellowship activities, we would risk spreading the disease. Couldn't have Bible study, couldn't have ministry or committees. We even had to limit how we do mission or outreach because of spreading the disease. Didn't matter what size church, all of us were in the same boat. We were scared. We were worried. We locked ourselves away. But we had hope. We all adapted. Well, most of us. They say around 80% of the country, all the churches around the country, 80% instantly went to online service. Where a very small percentage were online before that. We instantly figured out how to adapt. Wonderfully, we had an opportunity to videotape the worship service and share it online. And this megachurch pastor was saying how important and integral that is into the future. Now that it's begun, we can't stop it. It's part of the world. And as wonderful as we do, and wonderful and support we have from people that watch it, he was saying we're not doing enough. This megachurch pastor was saying that there are churches that have thrived during this COVID time because they're doing worship online. They're doing Bible study online. They're doing small group ministry online. They're doing group meetings of book groups and couples retreats and marriage counseling online. And some churches have thrived because they were already doing it. And so when the pandemic hit, apparently people had to find a way to worship. And these churches were already doing it. And people flocked to them. There's a whole generation of people out there that are already connected online. They go to work online. They go to school online. They play games together online. They get entertainment, sports, TV channels, movies, all online. Through their laptops, their tablets, their computers, their cell phones. They're all interconnected. They meet up and talk and chat online. There's a whole generation of people doing this, so churches have figured out why not do that? Why not offer faith online? And so some churches are. In fact, this minister was telling us about the highest growing churches in the country, in the world, right now. 54 churches in this United States were doing. They were online in the Middle East. That's the fastest growing Christian churches in the world right now. Online churches in the Middle East, where people cannot gather as Christians in a Muslim world safely. They cannot come to a place to gather together, to hear scripture read of the Gospels. But online, they have found out they can connect. They can support each other. They can read scripture and hear it read to them. They can discuss the Bible. They can discuss faith. They can support in any way they can each other in their life that they share together. And this megapastor is basically stressing the importance of this online generation that is happening. And that might seem strange to us because that's not the way we do it. We thought we were radical because we have an online video that we put out on Sunday afternoon. That's not radical. But I was wondering, does it make any difference? They're online. That's great. That's wonderful. We're in person. That's great. That's wonderful. It doesn't matter, when I was listening to this, if we are a church of 5,000 or a church of 2 people. All churches, if they're online, in a building, in a coffee shop, at someone's house, all have the same purpose. Doesn't matter who you are or where you're going. The purpose of the church is to worship, to have fellowship, to grow disciples, to be about ministry, and to do mission. It doesn't matter if you're a mega church, online church, a building, brick and mortar church. That's the goal of every church. And while the online may be strange to us, we try what we do, what we can. Just as other churches are meeting in houses, or at coffee shops, or bowling alleys. We all do those 5 things. We try to do worship. We have fellowship. We build disciples. We do ministry. And we offer mission. Those are the 5 core things that Jesus outlines in our gospel reading today. To every church. Long before there were church buildings, and really long before there was internet, there was the church. A community of faith. Doesn't matter where they're at or how they were. They were a community of faith. In the gospel reading, we hear those 5 important purposes of the church being exhibited. They are laid out there. John starts that chapter by saying, on the evening of that resurrection day, the disciples were gathered together in that room behind locked doors. That's fellowship. They're doing fellowship. They're together. These men and women had lost their leader. They were scared. They were mourning. They were grieving. They were terrified. They were fearing emotional wrong. And they came together to support each other. They could have scattered. They could have traveled to other towns. They didn't know if they'd be next. Their leader, a revolutionary who opposed the people, was tried and convicted on those charges, executed for those things. They were co-conspirators. They could be caught the next day. They could be hung on a cross. They didn't know what their future had. They could have went home and forgotten it all and tried to deny it. They were feeling guilty. They had run away. They had abandoned Jesus, and at least one of them denied him publicly 3 times. But they all gathered together to support each other, to be together emotionally. That's fellowship. That's what it means to be brothers and sisters in the faith, to support each other, to be with each other, to walk together in this life. And while they're gathered together in this moment of fellowship and the sharing of emotions, in this mourning and grief, in this guilt, in this worry, Jesus suddenly appears John said they rejoice. That's worship. That's worship. Rejoicing that we have a risen Lord that is with us. That death does not have a hold on him. They rejoice because they celebrate God is with them. That's what we gather here to do. To rejoice that we have a resurrection Lord that offers forgiveness of sins, that redeems us and gives us a way into his kingdom, promising us that we are his children now and forever. We rejoice in that. Sometimes it don't sound like we rejoice in that. I'll be honest with you. And with masks, it's very hard to see if you're even smiling right now. But when we say, he is risen, that's rejoicing. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. That's a greeting that goes back to those early disciples of rejoicing. That's a sign of worship. And in fact, even in the words of Thomas, worship is extended to also identify who God is. When Thomas sees Jesus that second weekend, he says, my Lord and my God. He identifies Jesus as Lord and as God. That's part of worship also. Coming here knowing that we are mortal, that we are helpless, that we are guilty, that we have sinned, that we have fallen, and we look to our Lord, our God, in all his glory. Look to our Savior Jesus and identify him as our Lord, our Messiah, our God. That's worship. They also built discipleship. While Jesus was there and they rejoiced, he breathed on them. He breathed on them. Breathed out his spirit upon them and said, peace be with you. Not once, but twice. In 2 weeks. Peace be with you. Breathing out the Holy Spirit upon them, encouraging them, building them up. That's discipleship. Growing somebody into a faith. These disciples have been Jesus' disciples for 3 years. They left their boats, they left their nets, they left their home, they left their tax table. They had followed him. They had watched him do his work. They had heard his sermons. They had seen his miracles. He had even commissioned them to go out and do the same things at times, giving them tasks to complete. And they had fulfilled it all. They were disciples. But like everybody else, now they also have a problem. The last few days have weighed heavy on them. They need to be rejuvenated. They needed to be renewed. And Jesus appears to them and breathes on them the Spirit, renewing them again to be disciples. To overcome the doubts, the fears, the worry. To be able to go out renewed, rejuvenated as God's disciples. Even Thomas, like many people, doubt and refuse to see, refuse to hear unless they can see. But Jesus comes to him also and convinces him, showing once again how to be a disciple. It's a sign and the purpose of the church is to encourage each other to be disciples, to go out and share the message, to tell people about worship, to tell people about God, to tell them about the message of Easter, to offer them the love and support and care, like blankets to go to the hospital, to do those many things. That's part of being a disciple of the Lord, and to encouraging other disciples. Which leads us to ministry. We also are charged to do ministry. When Thomas wasn't with them, the disciples rejoiced. They saw Jesus. They rejoiced. They were filled with the Spirit. They were commissioned. And then when Thomas shows back up, they do ministry to him. Thomas is still in the dark. He's still in the dark place. He's still in the grief and the mourning. John just says one line. We have seen the risen Lord. But I'm sure there was more to it. Ministry is teaching someone, assuring them of God. Ministry is caring for them where they're at. That whole entire week, Thomas was still filled with doubt, still worried, still fearful. And I'm sure they told him over and over again that they had seen the risen Lord, trying to convince him, teach him, guide him, support him. That's ministry. It's ministry, which also leads to mission, to being going out, to being sent. Jesus sends them as he has been sent. He tells them to forgive as God has forgiven them. Go and forgive. Go and teach. Go and help. Go and care. Go. This is mission. He sends them out. Not the first week, not the second week, but both weeks. And every time after, he sends them out. Sends the church out. This is the church. These are the people. It's long before the internet, long before there was church buildings. There was a fellowship. There were people worshiping. No matter where they were at, they worshiped. They joined together in fellowship. They built each other up in discipleship. They offered ministry to teach, to help, to care. And they went out and shared their message with the world. That's the mission of the church. That's the purpose of why we are here. It doesn't matter if we're a mega church, an online church, or a church of 45, or online, 25 more. Let's say we're at 70 today. It don't matter. We're a church of 70. Imagine with the Spirit of God and God's help what we can do. That first Easter night, there was only 11 disciples. And a few women gathered together. And they changed the world. Imagine what God can do with us. If we but trust and believe. If we worship. We have fellowship together. We build each other up in discipleship. We offer ministry. And we go forth in mission. Let us fulfill that purpose of the church this day, celebrating the Easter message and sharing it with the world. Amen. And may the peace and grace of God be with you this day and throughout this week to come. Amen.
Oh,
living together in trust with hope, let us now confess our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten from the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate of the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified and plunged his power. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again.
Thank you.
Praise your name and join the unending hymn. Gave thanks and gave it for all the time.